As soon as I saw them, my mind was blown. My mind opened up like that and just dribbled on out. I just couldn't believe what they could do.
The things that they did, no one else could do. And I think they are the greatest dancers that ever lived.
In a career spanning 7 decades, the high-flying Nicholas Brothers astonished audiences around the world with their virtuosity, charm, and athletic grace. Though they effortlessly defied gravity throughout their career, the team struggled to leap beyond the ever-looming barriers of prejudice.
The Nicholas Brothers had to be pioneers just to survive the racial discrimination that was all around them.
But from the Cotton Club to Hollywood, the brothers opened doors of opportunity with their talent and continue to inspire as living legends of dance.
Almost 69 years that I have been in show business and loved every moment of it.
So every time I see my movies, I say, wow, you know, did we do that, really?
In 1914, America was moving to a rhythm set by the assembly line of Henry Ford's motor cars, movie house pianos scoring silent films, and the syncopated beat of ragtime. Among the musicians making that joyous sound were Viola and Ulysses Nicholas, a college-educated couple who became proud parents on October 20th, 1914, in Mobile, Alabama. Determined that everything about their son would be special, they christened him with an exotic European name, Fayard Antonio. Months later, the family left the segregated South for the more integrated North, and in Philadelphia, they found success as pit musicians at a black vaudeville theater, The Standard. Each night, infant Fayard swayed in his bassinet to the pulse of his parents' music.
Mother played piano, father played drums. I had wonderful parents. They were the best in the world. They taught us right from wrong. And I just loved them. I loved them.
As he grew into an extroverted adolescent, Fayard would spend every day in the audience, enraptured by the elegant tap dancers on stage. The sound of applause and the glamorous lives of the performers ignited in him a desire to be a part of this world. A world that transcended the racial barriers all too common in the 1920s.
I said to myself, they're having fun up there. I would like to be doing something like that. So just by watching, I taught myself how to perform. I used to walk down the street, and I see a fire hydrant. I jump over the fire hydrant into a split and come up.
On March 17th, 1921, Fayard and his younger sister Dorothy were joined by a brother. And before long, Harold Nicholas was Fayard's faithful disciple.
His movements could never be replaced. He's like a poet with his talking to you with his feet and hands. He was always there for me.
Soon, Fayard was choreographing professional routines for the pair.
I taught my brother. And my father was watching me one day as I was rehearsing. And he said, son, there's something that you do I like very much. I said, what is that, Dad? He said, I like the way you use your hands. He said, do more of that. I said, okay, Dad. And so that's how we got the Nicholas Brothers style.
In 1931, the team made its stage debut at The Standard, where they stunned the crowd with their adult sophistication. And within months, they were star attractions at all the local black vaudeville houses.
Even though they were kids, they moved like adults. Usually you have to work into being good. It seems that they were good right from the beginning.
The protective Viola made sure her sons were dressed in impeccable suits and spit-shine shoes.
She was a real theatrical mom. She understood everything about the business, and she fought for them and stood by them. They always presented a portrait of dignity and elegance and pride in who they were and what they were about.
Popular stage acts were naturals for the movies. And in 1932, Warner Brothers Studios hired the excited dance duo to make their first screen appearance in a low-budget movie short titled Pie Pie Blackbird. But a greater offer lay just ahead. By the early 1930s, Harlem was the most prosperous black community in America. And at its heart, on the corner of 142nd Street and Lenox Avenue, stood the glamorous Cotton Club. It was run by powerful gangsters and was patronized by a white celebrity clientele who sipped champagne as they were entertained by the likes of Bill Robinson, Ethel Waters, and Cab Calloway. But black faces were found only on stage. The Cotton Club was completely segregated.
Black people couldn't go there. And the doorman, he would stop you. And the doorman was black. I didn't like that at all. Not at all.
In 1932, 17-year-old Fayard and 11-year-old Harold made their Cotton Club debut before a star-studded audience. Their stunning number stopped the show, and after that triumphant night, no singer or dancer dared to follow them. The Nicholas family moved to Manhattan, where Fayard and Harold lived in a world pampered and protected from the harsh reality known to most African Americans.
Now, the first show at the Cotton Club was 12 midnight. And maybe we wouldn't leave the club until maybe like 5 or 6 o'clock in the morning. Then we go to our apartment, and then we go to bed. Try to get some sleep, because our teacher would be coming there at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. She would leave, and we'd go back to bed until it was time to get up and have our dinner. And our chauffeur would be outside waiting for us. We had this long limousine, and we get in the car, and he'd drive us right to the Cotton Club.
The brothers grew extremely close, despite their age difference and their drastically different personalities. Fayard was outgoing, friendly, and optimistic. Harold was cool, distant, and emotionally detached.
Harold was the cute one, and Fayard was the one that held the two together. Fayard really worked hard. Harold kind of had a casual thing about him. It was a difference in styles, in a way.
Both young men were favorites of the Cotton Club chorus girls, especially the seductive Harold, who from an early age found women irresistible.
It was fabulous. The people, the way they act, the pretty girls and everything. It was great.
Each night, star patrons like Charlie Chaplin, Gloria Swanson, and Al Jolson asked to meet the amazing pair. And although black performers were not allowed to mingle with the all-white audience, for the irrepressible Nicholas brothers, the house manager made an exception.
He said, go on out there. Now, we were just little boys, but the rest of the cast couldn't go. But I'm glad we did go out there, because we started something like integration.
Although the Great Depression had brought America to its knees, the Little Princes of Harlem were making more money than most adults. And in 1933, 12-year-old Harold reported to Paramount's Astoria Studios on Long Island to appear briefly in the movie drama The Emperor Jones, starring Paul Robeson.
Thank you.
But the Nicholas brothers had just begun their climb to stardom. Their fame would soon spread across the country as one of the movie's most powerful moguls summoned them to Hollywood. In 1934, the Nicholas brothers made their first trip to California to appear in producer Samuel Goldwyn's lavish musical, Kid Millions, starring Eddie Cantor. In glamorous Hollywood, the pair got to meet many of their idols, like the world's most celebrated dancer, Fred Astaire, then filming Top Hat at RKO Studios.
After he finished synchronizing his steps, so we went out, I said, okay, let's do the time step. I said, da-da-da-da-da-da. Ah, yes. Oh, time step. Time step. Oh, yes. So we had so much fun doing it. And we were friends ever since.
In 1935, the brothers won featured parts in Paramount's musical The Big Broadcast of 1936. The future looked bright for the Nicholas family, which seemed inseparable. But in 1935, tragedy struck when the boys' father, Ulysses, suffered a fatal heart attack. The brothers had lost not only a parent they loved, but one of their greatest champions. The resourceful Viola Nicholas quickly took charge of her son's careers, and in 1936, the brothers made their Broadway debut, joining Bob Hope in the Ziegfeld Follies. Their choreographer was ballet genius George Balanchine.
And he says, fellas, I'm happy to meet you. I've seen your movies. Would you get up on stage and just do a little something for me? He said, sure. So we got up on stage. I jumped over my brother's head into a split. He went through my legs into a split. And we were just doing all these crazy things. He said, did you ever take a ballet? No, we never did. He said, well, it looks like it.
Going underneath the legs and the somersaults and all of that and doing their fast breaks and over the tops and everything else, they could do so many combination of things. That I think that's one of the things that made them so exciting. Of course, you see their smiles and how much they sincerely love each other.
The brothers reteamed with Balanchine on Broadway the following year for the Rodgers and Hart musical Babes in Arms. The show was a smash, running 289 performances. After its long run, the pair returned to their unofficial home, the Cotton Club, where one fateful day, a trio of singing beauties caught their eyes. At the trio's center was a shy 16-year-old named Dorothy Dandridge.
I looked at my brother and said, look over there. My main eye is on Dorothy Dandridge, and I want to get a little closer to her. And brother was the same way. Then I could say she was paying more attention to my brother, so I backed out. Because my brother and I, we never fight over women.
16-year-old Harold was deeply struck by Dorothy's vulnerability and exquisite beauty. On his best behavior, he courted her on dates chaperoned by her protective family.
Dorothy was very, how can I say it? She wasn't shy, but she was, you know, quiet, so to speak. And I was the outspoken one.
But the burgeoning relationship was put on hold in 1939. The Nicholas brothers were booked on a tour of South America, where they thrilled audiences alongside the bombshell from Brazil, Carmen Miranda. The entertainer was about to make her Hollywood movie debut in a big-budget Technicolor musical, Down Argentine Way, produced by 20th Century Fox. Don Ameche and Betty Grable would provide romance, but studio head Daryl F. Zanuck hedged his bets by adding one more musical act to the picture. Fox choreographer Nick Castle was excited by the possibilities the versatile brothers offered, and together they crafted a number that broke ground with its combination of elegance and athleticism. Director Irving Cummings wanted to shorten the number, but Nick Castle fought to keep it intact. The studio finally agreed to show the scene Castle's way at a sneak preview.
Nick called me right after the scene, and he said, "Listen, after your number, the audience in the theater were clapping their hands, stomping their feet, whistling, that the operator in the projection room had to rewind the film and show it over again."
The number stayed intact and went on to become a Hollywood classic. The shrewd Zanuck signed the brothers to a 5-year, non-exclusive contract, a rarity for black performers in Hollywood. The pair resettled in Los Angeles. And they were soon back on the Fox lot, filming a specialty dance for the musical Tin Pan Alley.
They were supposed to be in a harem, and I never saw dancing like that before in my life. Fayard with his long legs and his gorgeous hands and arms and his attitude, and Harold with his close little tight moves and the power of their legs. I mean, any famous ballet dancer couldn't possibly do the things that they did.
It was a guarantee. You put the Nicholas brothers in the film, you're gonna have a show-stopping number in your film. All those amazing steps and tricks and stunts.
But the Nicholas brothers were not allowed to appear with the film's headlining stars, Alice Faye, Betty Grable, and John Payne. In all of their Fox movies, the brothers' routines were staged so they could easily be cut when the film was shown in racially tense areas like the Deep South.
At that time, it was all right to be in the movie if you were separate. But they were never integrated in with the white cast, which is shocking to me.
By 1941, Harold was pressing Dorothy Dandridge to set a wedding date. She was hesitant, but in the meantime, they formed a different partnership on film. In Sun Valley Serenade, starring Sonia Henie and the Glenn Miller Orchestra, the brothers were signed to dance to a new song, Chattanooga Choo Choo. At first, they hated the tune, so they convinced Fox to hire Dorothy for some extra.
the Nicholas brothers was just like putting butter on a hot biscuit, child. And that we appreciate a lot because, you know, there was very little sexuality allowed between black people in the early films.
In 1941, another special woman was about to join the Nicholas entourage. While appearing in Chicago, Fayard met a beautiful college student with a quick sense of humor and sharp intellect. Her name was Geraldine Pate.
Well, I was totally fascinated with his lifestyle, his experiences. He seemed so vulnerable. You wanted to immediately protect him. I think anyone's first impression of Fayard is he's probably one of the nicest human beings in the world.
Now, all the time, I always thinking I just want to be a bachelor. I didn't want to get married. I just want to meet nice little girls and just have a ball. But Geraldine really fascinated me. So as we were leaving to get back to the theater, I said to everybody, oh, I'm going to marry that girl.
True to his word, Fayard married Jerry Pate less than a month later in January of 1942. And 8 months later, Harold followed his brother's lead when he walked down the aisle with Dorothy Dandridge. The Nicholas brothers were on top of the world, and soon they would climb even higher while struggling against barriers of race and facing family heartbreak.
A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I got a gal.
Where?
In Kalamazoo.
Kalamazoo!
By 1942, the Nicholas brothers were among America's most famous black entertainers, thanks to their stunning specialty numbers for 20th Century Fox films.
The Nicholas brothers had tremendous impact, and specifically, I mean, for black people. Black audience would go to see a movie and know that they were going to see the Nicholas brothers and feel that kind of pride.
But their talent could not protect them from the shadow of racism. Their color barred them from even entering the Fox studio commissary. Humiliated, they drove home for meals until Daryl Zanuck learned of the brothers' demeaning situation and insisted they be allowed inside. For Harold, life at home was also filled with tension. The born lady killer was flagrantly unfaithful to his lonely wife, Dorothy.
I wanted to be a big man, you know, show that I wasn't just a youngster or something, you know. And I was just horrible. And I loved her, you know, but I was too terrible.
On screen, however, the brothers never made a misstep. And in 1943, they filmed the sequence that sealed their place in cinema history. Fox's all-black musical Stormy Weather featured Lena Horne, Bill Robinson, Fats Waller, and Cab Calloway.
And they stop, then they jump on the piano. they exit camera right to that beautiful white staircase. They play with us, they do three or four splits, they go back, they come up without using their hands. So when they head up on the right side of the staircase, it's beautiful. It's so beautiful. I mean, every time they land, that could be a beautiful picture. And then, bam.
We never rehearsed it, but we could picture in our minds what we were really supposed to do. And we start doing it, one step right after the other. And Nick Castle, our dance director, said, cut. That's it. You cannot get it any better. And I said, let me tell you this.
Well, don't go back too far.
Just no, no, wait. Let me tell you this.
Tell him what your favorite number was.
Let me get a chance to talk.
How much chance do you want?
Well, you shut up. I loved all of them. Because I could see the progress of each one. See, because we would always try to make the next film better than the last one.
Yeah, I told him that already.
You did?
Yeah.
After their success in Stormy Weather, the brothers dreamed of more important film roles, while Harold also aspired to a solo singing career. But in March of 1943, the team faced separation for the first time. A continent away, World War II raged on, and Fayard was drafted, becoming Private Nicholas. Stationed in Mississippi, the elegant dancer soon found himself assigned to a laundry detail in an all-black unit. Back in Los Angeles, Harold turned his energies to his two passions, golf and women. He was rarely home and spent little time with his pregnant wife. On September 1st, a pain-stricken Dorothy tried to convince Harold that their baby was on the way. But he casually dropped her off at the home of Jerry Nicholas, taking the car and leaving them stranded.
Harold had pulled a little, what he called funny, and he left the keys, and we thought we had the car. But we did find a man going to work and got her in, but she kept holding back. She said, Harold is going to come, he's going to come.
But after more than 15 hours of labor, Harold was still missing. And on September 2nd at 2:42 a.m., Harold Suzanne Nicholas was finally born. Dorothy was overjoyed, and her child's presence made Harold's absences easier to take. In April 1944, a relieved Fayard was discharged from the army, and the following year, he became the father of a son, Tony. But like Harold, the proud father soon became an absentee parent.
I tried to be a good husband and a good father. Something happened. I don't know what. But like she said, I'm not, well, a lot of show people are not the real family type.
By the age of 2, Tony had begun to speak, but Harold and Dorothy's daughter, age 4, could not. To their horror, the couple realized that something was seriously wrong with their child. Finally, a doctor confirmed their worst nightmare. Harold had irreparable brain damage.
Because Daddy had held back, Lynn was denied oxygen. And that was a contributing factor.
Harold was such a beautiful little girl. I always felt so bad about that. I don't know how my brother feels about it. He never talks about it much. I know inside he's sad. He's sad about it.
I didn't want to show it, you know. It's like a lot of men, even nowadays, they feel pain, but they don't want to show it.
In 1948, the brothers made their last film appearance as a team, alongside Gene Kelly in The Pirate. But unlike white dancers such as Kelly or Astaire, their race still relegated them to brief supporting roles. To stay on top, Fayard and Harold would have to look beyond America and sidestep new obstacles in the decade to come. By 1948, the Nicholas Brothers' career had cooled in Hollywood, but audiences still embraced the dazzling duo, especially when they traveled abroad.
Well, we had just great times in Europe, never thinking about prejudice or anything like that. It was all open arms.
Europe became the brothers' home into the early 1950s. In London, they danced for the royal family. In Egypt, their admirers included King Farouk. Harold was especially drawn to Europe's racial climate and its women.
Europe, for me, was a haven. I tried to learn the language. I loved to talk to the ladies, you know, because that's where I learned most of my languages from.
In 1950, Fayard became the father of another son, Paul. But even when his wife, Jerry, joined him on tour, Fayard was far from faithful.
It seems as though when I went to Europe, everything went wow. All these beautiful girls from Italy, from France, from England, from Sweden, from Switzerland. I went wild. And my wife heard about it.
The bellboy came to the room and he said, "Mr. Nicholas, the young lady that you brought along on the tour wants to know, is she going to stay in this hotel or the one across the way?" And I had to translate for him. So he took his shoe and threw, "You dumb sucker."
Although Jerry could stand up to her rivals, Dorothy was deeply wounded by Harold's infidelities. Their marriage was at an impasse, and in 1951, the couple divorced. 8-year-old Lynn was placed with a caretaker as Harold withdrew into work.
It ended rather bitterly. It was terrible to watch.
In January of 1953, the brothers returned to America to perform at the inauguration of Dwight D. Eisenhower. But although they counted presidents and kings among their fans, they soon faced bitter discrimination again when they joined Frank Sinatra to headline at the Sands Hotel in Las Vegas.
Between shows, I walked into the lobby. I'm sitting there. All of a sudden, one of the guys of the hotel came up to me. He says, "You're not supposed to be sitting here. You should be back in your dressing room." I said, "I'm just here minding my own business. I'll go to my dressing room when I feel like it."
Harold had quite a to-do with one of the very big entertainers who attempted to rub his head for good luck. And it was something that came out of slavery. And he would say, "You're white, but I'm talented. Don't ever dare treat me less than a man." So this man says, "Well, we're going to make Sammy Davis a star, and you're not going to work anymore." He says, "Fine, there's the world. I can work in the world."
Harold stood by his words, launching a solo career in France. During his stay, he married seamstress Eliane Patron in a short-lived union that produced a son, Melly. Meanwhile, Jerry Nicholas had had enough of Fayard's philandering. They divorced in 1956, but remained close friends. The 60s would be an era of explosive unrest in America. Across the nation, blacks marched for civil rights, and U.S. soldiers were being called to fight in the distant jungles of Vietnam. In 1965, Harold joined his brother and Bob Hope to entertain American troops in Vietnam, only 50 miles from enemy fire. Once back in the States, tragedy hit close to home. On September 8th, 1965, the brothers received the shattering news that Harold's ex-wife, Dorothy Dandridge, had been found dead of an apparent drug overdose. Harold suffered the loss with typical stoicism.
I never had a chance to talk to her, to tell her that I was sorry. And she died. I was real low after that.
But 2 years later, there was cause once again to celebrate in the Nicholas family when Fayard married a lovely, sophisticated model named Barbara January.
She was good for me in so many ways. I've been lucky with my wives. And they're all beautiful, and they take good care of me.
But as the dancers entered their 50s, their careers began to move to a slower tempo. In 1970, Fayard gave a dramatic performance as a man falsely accused of murder in the movie The Liberation of L.B. Jones, opposite Lola Falana.
Everybody loved what I did in that film. And I thought, wow, I'm going to get some other roles. But they never did call me.
In the 1974 film Uptown Saturday Night, Harold played a Harlem gangster opposite Bill Cosby and Sidney Poitier. But again, what seemed to be a new beginning became a frustrating one-shot appearance.
What can I tell you? I mean, I don't know, really. I wonder sometimes, most of the times I wonder, what happened, why, you know, what did I do wrong? What did I do wrong?
By now, musicals had disappeared from movie screens, and many young African-Americans saw the Nicholas Brothers as old-fashioned stereotypes from an earlier, unenlightened Hollywood. It appeared that after 45 years of stardom and struggle, the brothers were facing their last dance in the limelight. But appearances can be deceiving. After fading from the spotlight in the 1970s, the Nicholas Brothers would enjoy a decade of renewal and rediscovery in the 1980s. It was thanks partly to popular dancers like Gregory Hines, who embraced tap as a black American art form. Harold starred on stage in The Tap Dance Kid and won raves when he replaced Gregory Hines in the musical Sophisticated Ladies.
This is the kind of thing I wanted to do all along, you know. I wanted to do for myself. But it was great. It was beautiful.
Even when he was like 65, Harold was like a freak of nature. Harold was still jumping off staircases into splits.
Harold also found happiness with a Swedish jazz promoter named Rigmor Newman. She became his manager and his life companion, a woman sensitive to his private, sometimes moody personality.
It's very difficult to get close to Harold for, you know, he's very, very honest. He's also selfish, but he is a good person, good-hearted. He brought a lot of joy into my life.
In 1989, 75-year-old Fayard was thrilled to receive a Tony Award for choreographing the Broadway dance revue Black and Blue. It was one of many awards the brothers received over the next decade, awards recognizing them as irreplaceable national treasures. And no accolade was more prestigious than the one they received in 1991 when they were saluted in Washington, D.C. at the Kennedy Center Honors.
The Nicholas Brothers. We owe to you. We owe so much to you. And we love you so much, Harold and Fayard.
I cried, you know. All those honors, Kennedy Center honor and stuff like that. That sort of brought up things and, you know, tears to my eyes.
Here I am, 84 years old, and I'm getting all of these awards that I should have gotten years ago.
But amid the applause came another painful loss. In 1998, while Fayard recuperated from a stroke, his devoted wife Barbara was hospitalized with an inoperable tumor. And 3 weeks later, Fayard lost his beloved companion to cancer.
I miss her so much. We were married 28 years. And it was great 28 years. I was so much in love with her, and she was beautiful inside and out.
It broke my heart when Barbara died, because I just saw them as this eternal couple. And I saw Fayard not too long ago at an autograph session, and he's carrying on with that wonderful, cheerful attitude he has.
Buoyed by the support of his family, including his sons Tony and Paul, Fayard has continued to make appearances around the world. In 1998, at age 84, he performed on stage with his granddaughters, 13-year-old Nicole and 10-year-old Kathy.
My granddaughters have taken over, and they do the Nicholas Brothers in skirts.
For seven decades, the Nicholas Brothers have electrified audiences and inspired fellow entertainers through the eloquence of their art. They demanded their full rights as human beings while scaling heights unsurpassed in the history of dance.
I think I'm glad to be here.
I second the motion.
I'm so fortunate to have known them for all my life. We're still pals. We call each other all the time. And we get together. We do a couple of steps, slowly, and have a good time.
Child, if you get them together now, they'll still try to split, honey. You give Fayard that cane, honey, he'll go down. He may not come back up as quick, but he will go down, I'm telling you right now.
We stand on the shoulders of the people that came before us. I have been afforded stages to tap dance on because of the great Nicholas Brothers. And thank you, Harold and Fayard. Thank you.
My brother is the most versatile actor, singer, dancer. He does everything. And I'm so proud of him, because I taught him everything he knows.
I'm proud of you, too.
Yeah. How about that?